of 68 Best Bets show presented by BetRivers. It is March. We are the three-man weave, and we're excited that the calendar has finally turned away from February because the tournament gym is oh so soon. Conference tournaments are happening this week and next week leading up to Selection Sunday. We got some other regular season games in there still, but man, nothing better than conference tournament season, in my opinion, except that first weekend in March, first weekend in the tournament in mid-March when we go to Vegas. I can't wait. It's the best time of the year. Jim, takeaways from yesterday, what you got?
First one, worried about Zakai Ziegler for Tennessee. Went down non-contact. Looked really, he was in a lot of pain, did not return, supposedly getting a scan today. We'll see where that goes. That certainly even more limits Tennessee. They talk about how much he's their heartbeat of that team. San Diego State, I have some real concerns. Going all the way back to last year against Creighton, end of game execution. Then earlier this year in Maui against Arkansas, last night against Boise, could not score in the final 4 minutes. In fact, I don't think they did score. Really, really troubling. They don't have a late game offense. It's Matt Bradley taking fadeaway jumpers. It's a serious issue. So definitely a little worried a bit about San Diego State. And then Matt, last takeaway, I'm lost on totals. 1-7, my last best bet totals last 8. So yeah, I got to figure something out.
I'm just laughing at myself. If you saw my totals record this year, it's not great. It's the reason why I'm where I am, but I'm less worried about the Aztecs. I just feel like that Max Rice thing was so insane that 9 times out of 10, that doesn't happen. They end up holding on. My takeaway though was Arkansas, Tennessee. Yeah, the Ziegler thing was notable, but maybe we overreacted in Arkansas against Alabama. Alabama was like 2 of 24 from three, and they're still down 10 late. Like maybe we got too excited about the Nick Smith resurgence, and I need to pump the brakes on Arkansas. Kai, I also fell into the trap last night. Final takeaway, Big Ten home teams. How about Indiana? Nope. How about Nebraska? Nope. So a trend's only a trend as long as it lasts, Kai. So just something to keep in mind.
That's right. Trend does not predict the future. That is the case. It's fun to talk about on video and form narratives around it for writing purposes, but not something to rely on solely. Yeah, Tennessee, Arkansas, clearly a takeaway for me as well. I think part of it is, you know, we forgot how good Tennessee is. Tennessee is good. They're still a very good team. Impressive win by them. VCU, they won the A-10 outright, so claps for the Rams. SLU, not a great season for them. We'll see what they can do in the A-10 tournament. Same goes for Dayton. That should be an interesting one, the A-10 tournament. You got a bunch of teams who basically underachieved all season. Be curious to see how that ends. Maybe somebody unexpected. Again, that's what makes March great. All right, let's get started with the real show here. Texas at TCU in the Big 12 is where we are starting. I'm still team TCU, guys. I'm gonna start off with that. But who have they beaten recently? Since January 21st, their win at Kansas, they're 4-6. Their wins, Oklahoma, West Virginia, Oklahoma State, and Texas Tech. That's a little concerning to me. I know Mike Miles is not out of the lineup, Matt, but still, this TCU team needs to prove something to me going forward for me to really trust them in the NCAA tournament.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, just from tonight's matchup perspective, it feels like more of a spot angle for Texas. Everything else about the matchup and just the team in general, I like TCU better. I think they're a little bit, you know, relative to Texas's value in the market, I tend to think they are the better value pick. But at this point in the season, especially in these power conference matchups, I think just the situational spot means way more than everything else. So you're catching TCU off that, you know, crazy win at Texas Tech against Texas, who just lost over the weekend. I just leaned Texas based on that alone, Jim, but nothing profound. But the current number's sitting at 2.5. Some people are coming in on the Horned Frogs. Maybe if it gets up to 3 or 4, I might bet the Horns, but nothing strong for me.
Yeah, big lean to TCU for me here. I actually gave this out on Green Dot Daily on Action Network. Not my best bet for this show, but definitely in TCU. Texas is 3-6 against the spread on the road this year, not covering by an average of 2 per game. I don't think that's especially strong. And I do think this version with Miles of TCU is so much better. The Hoop Explorer on-off stuff has them 10 points better. I know some people are not a huge fan of on-off stats, but I think that matches the eye test there. Significantly better with them out there. They don't have a ton of shooting, but I think you can still score inside against Texas. Kai, in the first meeting, TCU like controlled the entire thing. They were up 10-15 for like 25 of the 40 minutes. kind of gave it away late, rather unfortunate, not an awesome closing performance on the road, but I think we've seen the evidence that they can beat this Texas team and they will do so at home. So definitely lean towards Horned Frogs for me.
Yeah. Game one, Texas led by as many as 18 points, or excuse me, TCU led by as many as 18. Longhorns came back. They won it. But I do think TCU can compete. Texas off that road loss to Baylor, TCU at home, maybe that kind of gives them a little jolt that they need over the hump here. This is a pretty big game for them for S-curve purposes in the NCAA tournament. They're sort of stuck in the 5-7 no man's land territory. Would definitely be up towards that 5 line instead of the 7 line. So big game for them and in the Big 12 tournament seeding process as well. I lean towards TCU, -2.5. Next game here in the Big East, it's Xavier at Providence. The Friars, -3.5 at home. Game one was awesome. Xavier pulled out an overtime win after blowing a 14-point lead at their place. Jim, without Fremantle, Xavier's been a little pedestrian for my taste. Just 4-3 straight up. 4-3 against the spread as well, but their wins. Providence and OT, St. John's, DePaul, and a shorthanded Seton Hall team. Doesn't inspire a ton of confidence. What do you think?
Yeah, and some of their losses also just as uninspiring at this stage. Big change with Xavier is how much slower they're playing. I ran a little analysis before the show on teams that played slower in February versus their full season total, and they're way down. Kai, that's why this total is 8.5 points lower than KenPom. It's been hit with an absolute hammer down.
Wow.
Opened 157 in some places offshore. It's now 151.5. KenPom has it 160. A lot of people sniffing out that tempo change with Xavier. Matt, I kind of think that's gone too far. I'm starting to like the over, given how low it is. But it's hard to get too excited about, given that it doesn't seem like Xavier's interested in running as much anymore. And even the first meeting between these two was not fast. Only 72 possessions in overtime. So that, you know, you prorate that for 40 minutes and it's down like 65. That's not fast. So not a strong take. People have clearly hinted onto that. And then from a side perspective, I lean Xavier. I don't love Providence as a home favorite. Cooley splits, definitely weaker there, but I did not end up betting this game, Matthias.
Yeah, another thing too is I saw Desmond Clouds played a ton the last two games for Xavier. He's like a defensive, more of a defensive-minded Swiss Army knife type piece they really like. Just look at Sean Miller's history, right? I mean, Arizona, he played at a slower, more mediocre pace. You know, it was more of a gritty, grimy, physical type of identity. Obviously, a ton of talent there. But just what we saw from Xavier the first 2-3 months of the year wasn't really like in line with our perception of how Sean Miller likes to build his teams. I wonder if he was bemoaning their defensive issues and now is trying to kind of roll it back. And yeah, that was kind of my angle too, Jim, just how crazy the total was misaligned from the analytics and where the market had it. Kind of on the side, nothing profound here. Kind of leaned toward Providence, but I think it's laying a little too many at home. I know Providence is a dog at home would be a little more appetizing, but laying some margin doesn't excite me. I will be on the fence.
Yeah, Friars, so it's tough, well coached. They haven't lost all year at home. They're perfect. 10-5 against the spread, almost a +5 cover margin. I'm not fading that. 3.5 points seems about right given Providence's home court advantage, given the fact that I don't think Xavier's quite the same team without Zach Fremantle. He's supposed to come back, by the way, hopefully for maybe conference tournament action, but hopefully for sure for the NCAA tournament. So maybe a buy low on them once that happens. But right now, I'm staying away from Xavier. Lean towards Providence.
Yeah, I think the word Miller says he should start practicing this like midweek this week. So it's hard to expect him back for this game, but hopefully out there very soon.
Next game we got is a Big Ten matchup, Penn State at Northwestern. Amazing that this game matters this late in the season. Would not have expected that in the preseason here. Northwestern's -4 at home. Penn State still has a chance at the dance. That loss to Rutgers really hurts, but a win against Northwestern here would be their fourth Q1 win, their eighth Q1/Q2 win with no bad losses. They'd be right there. Matt, your take on this game?
Nothing profound here. Like, again, you're talking about Big Ten home, Kai. Northwestern, what's their home? I guess they've been the only team that's been good actually away from...
Whether you're asking the name of it.
Yeah, sorry. What's their ATS splits? I know they've been better away from home than most of the Big Ten teams, but still, I think the home road splits matter, despite the kind of zig against the Zag trend last night, Kai. Northwestern, I just can't. It feels like maybe a clinker dead spot tonight with Penn State coming to town, but again, I'm not betting against a Big Ten home team.
They're 9-8 at home.
Okay,
spread. Yes.
Yeah, nothing especially jarring in that direction. I'm curious what Penn State's psyche is like after completely collapsing against Rutgers on Sunday, likely blowing any potential chance at an at-large bid. Maybe if they win both games this week and a couple in the Big Ten tournament, they could get there. But I tend to think that that collapse at home was maybe the nail in the coffin for them. I still like that team, Kai. I like how they can space the floor and give teams problems, even despite not having size. But I also think Adige is a really good defender for Pickett. He's a fantastic 1v1 defender. He's big, strong enough to handle the post-up stuff that Pickett likes to do. So I don't love that part of the matchup for them, but I don't want to lay it at home with Northwestern. So also going to sit this one out.
Comment about senior night in the chat. I believe someone looked back at senior nights and found that teams on senior night actually had a negative ATS record or a bad ATS record. The narrative of, oh, is senior night the home team's going to play better? It's false. It's if there's any extra lean towards that in the market in terms of inflating the spread, I think you probably fade that. I'm not sure if there is in this game. I'm just saying, since it was brought up in the chat, I think that narrative's kind of, it doesn't impact the actual game.
It's bunk. I think there's just as likely to be nerves, right? Like, this is my last time. Yeah. I want to try to show out.
And you're going to play seniors that would normally play also.
At the start of the game, for sure.
Yeah. And even if three possessions, you wouldn't normally be playing, you know, backups, reserves.
Yeah. Yeah. In this game, ignoring that, battle of maybe the two best backcourts in the conference, which is interesting. Northwestern, I don't think they're going to rattle Pickett handling the ball. They've been really good at turning teams over this year. Pickett about as solid as they come. And Northwestern's been really bad at defending the three, both from a three-point attempt rate and percentage perspective. Obviously, that's very bad against Penn State. Northwestern also can't really punish Penn State inside, which has been their weakness defensively. I lean towards Penn State at plus four here. I think keep it close. You know, famous last words, Northwestern's been quite good lately, better than my expectations. Next game here, the Iron Bowl, Auburn at Alabama. Alabama minus 10. My question is, Jim, should we just fade Alabama again? 0-2 against the spread since the Miller news, clearly having an impact, but it is Road Auburn, so I digress.
That's my instinct, Kai, definitely kind of playing against Alabama here. That second half against Arkansas was really impressive, but we also have to remember the first half. Down at halftime, I think it was by 9, not looking sharp at all. Road Auburn has not been as bad this season as maybe we perceived over the season, over the past. 6-5 against the spread, basically even. Like, it's not a total auto fade. So getting 10 points, double digits with a team that does seem distracted and maybe isn't quite as locked in with their game planning and is more just kind of going from game to game. I lean towards the Tigers. It is a big rivalry. So sure, Alabama will be focused, but I do think getting 10 in a big rivalry with Auburn, like drifting towards the bubble in a way. I love the road Tigers here, Kai. I think it's just a little bit too many. Sorry, to Matt.
Hard stay away from me. I do think, you talked about how Auburn has been fine away from home this year relative to their home or away from home relative to their home performance. In Alabama, I talked about this. Like, I just think that maybe we oversold the Brandon Miller thing. It's been two games, not rushed to conclusions with that. But the fact they are up pretty substantially over Arkansas despite shooting terribly, I think just shows that their floor is really high. I think people recognize their ceiling's high, but their floor is really high. They can play consistently because they defend so well, especially with their ability to defend the rim. And that's where Auburn's the only place they're like reliable scoring wise. Maybe this is the game you get the Wendell Green breakout performance shooting. He certainly feels due for one of those highlight reel types of outputs. And we saw him do it to Alabama last season. I kind of lean toward Auburn, but nothing strong for me.
I just don't know how it doesn't affect Alabama, the outside noise, because anytime you're taking away from practice time and putting towards dealing with the media and putting towards other stuff is time you're taking away from practice time and game planning. And going to against the spread record, cover margin is terrible in those games, pretty much indicates that that's what's happening right now. But I don't really trust Auburn. They haven't won a road game since January 21st. Their three SEC wins in February were all at home. They're Mizzou, Georgia, and Ole Miss. They're 3-7 straight up in the last 10, 1-5 ATS the last 6. It hasn't been great lately. Jim said they are falling towards the bubble. I sort of think Alabama has its way with Auburn, but again, I do think the Miller distraction is real. I think Auburn plus 10 is the way I'd lean if forced to choose a side in this game. Chat mob part one. Jim, what do you got?
Kai, going to you for a 10 matchup leg show. Our local squad, Loyola Chicago, 4.5-point home favorite against Rhode Island, who, you know, has been mostly down this year. Not a whole lot of up and down for them.
Mostly down, and no Breon Freeman, who got kicked off the team. That gave him a bit of a bump at first. You know, it seems like a chemistry a juicer, I suppose, when he got kicked off and the team rallied around. But they've been terrible this season. I can't trust them on the road. They've been even worse on the road. And Loyola has shown a bit of fight lately, so I'd lean towards the Ramblers.
Matt, in the ACC, Pitt is a 3.5-point road favorite at Notre Dame. They clinch a share of the ACC title if they win this game. This is also Mike Bray's last home game in South Bend. Where do you see this one shaping up from an emotional slash like nerves perspective for Pitt? What do you got?
Yeah, Notre Dame has been competitive, but the fact that you have a motivated short road favorite in Pitt here legitimately chasing an outright ACC title, on top of the fact that Notre Dame has basically five players right now. They played Carmody last game. They have no one else to throw out there because Starling didn't play, and nor did Hammond. They basically have seven dudes. Now they're down to five. If Starling's already confirmed out for tonight, I don't have the update on Hammond. I'm sorry, but I kind of lean toward Pitt, even though it feels like a let's all put our chips in for the Mike Bray senior night hurrah thing. I lean toward Pitt.
Yeah, it's not ideal. What's going on with their rotation? It's almost non-existent. Joey asked about the Texas A&M total battle, Commerce versus Corpus Christi. I should lean under, but actually digging into, like I said, the analysis around February tempo, Commerce was up a little bit over possession. Pretty much every is down on average because of conference play. So when there are teams that are actually up, hard to really get excited about betting those unders. So staying away from the A&M total battle. And from Kelly V, also in the same conference, New Orleans versus McNeese, I do the over there. I think that's going to be really, really up and down, especially the way New Orleans plays. Kai, in the NEC, the tournament starts today at campus site. St. Francis, Pennsylvania, SFU, is hosting Central Connecticut. 4.5-point home favorites are the Red Flash. What do you think of this one?
I have not had a feel for Central Connecticut all season. I would lean towards St. Francis. I think they are the much better team, but this conference is weird and parity reigns supreme. I'd probably lean towards dogs in this conference tournament just because I think home court means about nothing.
Yep. I mean, if there's one home court that matters, it's the Western PA travel, but still, I think postseason maybe negates that. It's not like one off in the doldrums of the season.
I'm on every road dog except for St. Francis. Very astute, both of you. Kind of reading between the lines.
There you go. Matthew, back to the A-10, UMass is an 11.5-point road dog at Duquesne, another team, Western PA here in Pittsburgh. You riding with the Dukes, or are you going with the Minutemen?
Not at the current price, but I certainly like betting the Dukes off of a loss. They've been one of the more volatile teams in college basketball this season, but they're playing to a very high level now. They're healthier than they were for most of conference play. I kind of think they smash UMass, but I don't really trust them to lay margin, especially with UMass, who is healthier, not all the way healthy, but healthier. So
Matt, I gotta do it. Our good pal Spencer Douglas asked if there are any other money lines like Butler that you're feeling.
no official money. You know, Jim, they kind of come to me on the spot. As we talk through the rest of the outline and second, I have a chat, Mom, maybe I'll throw it in there. But yeah, a little bit gun shy after Butler completely. How can Butler be that bad? How can that team be that bad?
It's nuts. It's wild. They're,
they can't possibly terrible. Be that bad.
It's a good question. Chuck Harris.
They took K-State to the woodshed.
Chuck Harris.
Chuck Harris is actually minus 10 points. I agree with that.
We'll keep moving. Southern Indiana versus SIU. Edwardsville's coming in best bets. So holstering that. Kai, Tulane, -6.5 at East Carolina. East Carolina, the only team in the country that hasn't blown out Tulsa recently. And that was a shorthanded Tulsa. And still no Javon Small for East Carolina. So what do you think with them?
Yeah, I lean Tulane. -6.5 on the road. Spread's about right, in my opinion. But I would lean towards the better form team right now in early March, late February sort of time frame.
Yep, agreed. Yeah. All right, two more, and then we'll go back to the line. Matthew, Utah State, 2.5-point road favorite at UNLV on the way to Vegas. Utah State desperately needs this one for tournament consideration. Do you think they get it?
Yeah, I kind of like UNLV here at the home dog spot, but they just have not been the same team with their injuries throughout conference play. Eli Parkett's back out again. There's one of the guys,
Rodriguez,
who I think really matters. Yeah, so it's a deep team. It's a team that I thought that would be immune to injuries, but clearly the ones that they've had have mattered. I mean, God, they're below 500 in conference play. So yeah, kind of like Utah State that I talked through, actually.
Those are their two best perimeter defenders Parquet and Rodriguez. I think that's going to show up.
They're built on defense.
Overlean as well. All right, last one. Before we go back to the outline, Kai, tell us about the Tigers. Tigers at Tigers, Mizzou on the road at LSU. Currently looking at a spread of Mizzou -4.
I lean towards our Tigers against the Purple Tigers. All Mizzou has to do is take care of business against two inferior opponents down the stretch here, and they can get a top four, top five probably now, seed in the SEC. I think they can do it and get it done. Jim, we've seen this team have letdowns for sure, and LSU did end up beating Vanderbilt the other day. Yep. But I think it gets it done here.
Yeah, I mean, Mizzou has not lost outside of quad one, knock on every bit of wood.
True. So this would be Q3 probably.
Yeah, keep that going and get the win there. All right, back to the outline. We've got Seattle and Utah Tech for later and a few others from the chat. So, Kai, back to you.
Let's stay in the SEC. We're going Vanderbilt at Kentucky. Another very big spread, double digits. Kentucky laying 10 at home. And they're rolling. They're starting to look like the team I think we expected in the preseason. CJ Frederick got in for a little bit last game, played 7 minutes, but I think he's clearly a sign of he's getting healthier. Four straight wins, Matt, four straight covers. Vanderbilt had a nice bounce back after that LSU loss. They're 6-1 over the last 7 games. Still have a prayer for the dance, but I would say they absolutely need this win to get their 10-point spread. Your thoughts?
I like the Vandy boys. I've kind of just thrown out the LSU game. Maybe that was, I'm overly cherry-picking my handicap here, but really do think the breadth of games with Robbins back has been just overwhelming evidence that he is such a game changer. This team's different with him. They just play much more in sync on offense with a guy they can throw it into inside. And on defense, my God, like he had, 9 blocks against Florida? He had 5 in the LSU loss. I mean, he just completely revamps their defense. So, yeah, I don't know. 10 feels like a little bit of a light number against Kentucky, even though Kentucky's not all the way. Kentucky still talented, dangerous, all that stuff. I still lean toward the Vandy boys, Jim.
Yeah, this feels a little bit going way back a while back when I think Kentucky laid about 10 to LSU. And now Vandy is better than LSU. And this Kentucky is way better than early January Kentucky. But I think they can kind of hang around, stay inside the number. Big battle inside with Oscar Liam Robbins. Robbins draws a ton of fouls. If you get Oscar in foul trouble, this thing gets really dicey for Kentucky. They don't want to have to go to Ware and Damian Collins as their chief interior players. They need Shibuya out there on the floor. I think that's been a big part of the resurgence is his trending back up towards All-American caliber of play. So keeping an eye on that one, Kai, potentially some live stuff if one or the other gets in foul trouble. If Oscar's able to put Robbins on the bench, I think Vandy has trouble too. So keeping an eye on that one if you're watching the game.
Yeah, game one wasn't close. I think you throw that one out because the Robbins, right, got in there. Kind of important against Kentucky's front line, Shibuya. I kind of lean towards Kentucky keeping it going, but 10 points is really darn high, and this Vanderbilt team is competent. So officially leaning towards Vanderbilt. Kentucky, I think, wins it. 10-point favorite, obviously, but Vanderbilt, hang on. Next game, Big Ten, Maryland at Ohio State. Maybe some out there are a bit surprised by the short spread. Maryland just -1 at Ohio State. Also, Jim, KenPom has this -2. So to me, I think it's interesting that this line is not higher for the Terps, number one, because it's the Terps versus Ohio State. We know how Ohio State's been playing. Number two, there's no Zed Key still for Ohio State. Smart market, perhaps? Your thoughts?
Potentially. Ohio State actually looked really good last home game over the weekend. Got a nice victory over the Jekyll and Hyde squad that is Illinois. On the other hand, Maryland is Jekyll and Hyde, but predictably they are home Jekyll and road Hyde. I think that's the right split there.
Who's between the bad guy? Who is who?
I always have that confused. But, I mean, they've been awful on the road. Their only road wins this year are Minnesota and Louisville. Like, that barely counts at this stage. No top 200 wins. And the fact that we actually saw signs of life from Ohio State, I think explains why the money's coming on the Buckeyes. That freshman classes, they're starting to assert themselves a little bit. Thornton's been really, really solid. One of the best like elbow jumpers you'll find in the league. He's so consistent at that. He and Sensabaugh. I actually lean towards Ohio State here, Matt, now that they're not completely mired in this disgusting total slump.
Yeah, I agree. And they played well against Penn State game before. Game was at home as well. So this is their third straight home game. I like backing younger teams, freshman-laden teams, which is what this Ohio State team is at this point at home. I'd like to be catching like an extra point or two, I'll be honest, just given how bad Ohio State played before that. And I still believe in Maryland. But Jim, you're right. They've been a completely different team away from College Park. So I kind of lean toward Ohio State. So
yeah. And again, it's strange to me that the market has gone towards Ohio State. I agree with it, by the way. I'm with Ohio State as well, but it's surprising still. Maryland, they've arguably been the best team in the Big Ten this past month. 8-2 against the spread, 7-3 against the spread, 8-2 overall. That Ohio State win, though, I think that set them right maybe a little bit. I don't want to overreact to one game, but that was an impressive game against Illinois. Maybe Key's absence has shaken things up just a bit to where the Buckeyes have more confidence going forward. Maybe it's more conducive to the style of play of their freshman guards. We know they're talented. We think Chris Holton's a good coach. It is a tough matchup from experience lens. Maryland, much more experienced. This is a very old team. They've been around the block times. And Ohio State obviously relies on freshmen. But at Ohio State, off that win, off that confidence, I lean towards the Buckeyes here. Next game, Sam Houston at Stephen F. Austin. I snuck this game on the outline. Yeah. Stephen F. Austin -1. It's a major game in the WAC, Matt. That's why I did it. Both teams might still be in play for a one seed in the WAC. I know Sam Houston is. SFA might need a lot of help. At least a two seed is in play for them. Sam Houston, fantastic year. Probably can't get an at-large, but they're 22-6. They won at Utah. They won at Oklahoma. That's nothing to sneeze at. And SFA is a frustrating team. Your thoughts?
Yeah, big rivalry game too here, right? Sam Houston's been quietly ho-humming the last few weeks. I don't think anyone's really taken notice. But, I mean, SFA's been solid, too. They've just been unable to close out close games. The Arlington one comes to mind. I guess they did get that one at Abilene Christian. I forgot they actually won that game. I thought they lost that. But hard toss-up for me here, Jim. I guess the one angle you might look at is the fact that Sam Houston won the first one just on a basic principle in a rivalry game, just take the other team in the rematch. SFA's health has now been... I mean, I guess, can we assume this is kind of the guys they have going forward? I mean, pretty much everyone's back except for Posey. I guess I lean SFA the more I talk through it, just given the fact that they lost that first one, probably a better team, a healthier team than that first matchup. Although I think everyone played in that first one too. So I don't know. Tough one to handicap for me.
Yeah, I don't have a great angle here. SFA has been decent against the spread at home. Sam Houston State's been decent above 500 against the spread on the road. Remember, they won at Oklahoma and Utah to start the year. I mean, totally different scenario here 3 months later, 4 months later, basically, at this stage. Yeah, Kai, I think this one's a tough handicap. I hope you've got something better since you got it on the outline.
Well, SFA is a high variance team. With the way they turn the ball over, with the way they force turnovers, anything can happen. Game one was close, but I trust Sam Houston way more than SFA. They will score inside against SFA easily, 62% in the first game. That's a given. They will get to the free throw line consistently and constantly. That's a given. So I'm going to trust the givens in this matchup. I'm going to trust the team I trust more and take Sam Houston as a dog, +1. You don't see them as a dog very much. Lean their way.
Last game. Shooting it. This is my guy. Cam Huffer's my guy. Shooter. Yeah. Aussie. Sam Houston. Makes no sense in that team. A complete outlier on that team.
Next game, we snuck this one on the outline. Of course we did, because it's the weirdest matchup of the day and maybe of the entire season. Chicago State is going to Gonzaga. Gonzaga's laying 27.5. It's a tune-up for the Zags pre-tourney. Very odd scheduling here. Nice of Mark Few to do this, I suppose, for Chicago State. Jim, there's not really some incentive here for the Zags to beat Chicago State by 40, but they could. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, it's going to be strange. I really wonder what kind of rotation they play in this game, because boy, would they feel dumb if they got someone hurt right before the WCC tournament playing a game that they did not have to schedule. Yep. So I would imagine second half, you might not see Drew Timmy for more than like 5 minutes tops. So I think if you bet Gonzaga, you should bet a first half. I see Matt Akers in the chat mentioning Chicago State backdoor. Yeah, I mean, Chicago State's going to play this game like it's, we need to win. We want to win. Last game of the year, independent schedule. They've got no tournament. This is it for them. Whereas Gonzaga, like the WCC tournament starts tomorrow. Gonzaga's not playing, but this is just a very strange one-off thing that I think is difficult with incentive-wise. I'm Chicago State full game, Gonzaga first half here.
I took Chicago State first half, and I guess it's kind of against conventional wisdom, but I do think that I think they're going to play a lot more of the unsung heroes, so to speak, in the first half. The Zags are, and just put yourself in Mark Few's headspace. Like, where have the Zags consistently fallen short in postseason play? I think they've fallen short when they haven't been able to get out in transition, teams have slowed them down. I think he uses tonight as like a let's practice like set plays, run half court offense, as opposed to like get up and down and you know run. Although I kind of feel like it's just Gonzaga's wired, so maybe I'm being a little bit too presumptuous there. That said, I like Chicago State quite a bit. I just they've made every team they've played this year close. Like they have not been blown out for the exception of two games early in the year. Now Gonzaga's the best team they've played, sure. But just something about the fact they've been there for this long, I think they're ready for it. There's zero risk of like them folding because of a, you know, just a fatigue or a tired factor. I think they keep it close. I really do. It's like, I think they're going to be down 30 and I'll just laugh at myself, but I feel like they keep this close.
Yeah. I mean, fatigue in place since February 19th, right? They're rested. they do have one more game after this at Fresno, but this is their second to last game of the season.
Rest versus rust.
Ooh. Right. So Chicago State's been in Spokane a few days already. I know because they tweeted about it. So they're acclimated to whatever environment they're in Spokane. They've practiced on the floor. They are scrappy underdogs. ATS 13-8 this year against the spread as an underdog. I think this game's up to Gonzaga. My feeling is, my lean is they don't care too much, but I'm not sure they can prevent themselves from blowing Chicago State out. Even if they play their backups, I don't think they can just try to not blow them out and still not do it. They are that good. They are that much better than Chicago State. So I would stay fully away. I have no feel in this game. All right, chat mob part two, Jim. Round it up.
Kai, I'm going to go to you for a whack question because you got SFA, Sam Houston, on the outline. So I know you're a whack loyalist.
Mm-hmm. Wacky whack.
Seattle at Utah Tech. Utah Tech laying 2 at home. Anything for you on that game?
I'm a little surprised Seattle's a dog. I definitely am not giving Utah Tech as much credit as they probably deserve. Seattle hasn't played great recently, but I lean towards Seattle here at +2.
No Grigsby last game for Seattle. So
that's important. We'll probably stay away with injury issues. That's probably why they're at +2. Yep.
Grigsby. All right, Matthew, Grigsby. You get another one from the WAC. I'm just keeping the family here. I've got a small take on this game. Curious what you say. Southern Utah. -5.5 hosting Grand Canyon, so not too far from Utah Tech. I think about 30 minutes between those campuses. What do you think?
I like the T-Birds, but I like them first half. Feels like a little too high. I think the Grand Canyon's been playing more as an over team, so I'm not as hesitant to fade them with teams laying margin because they're not playing as stuck in the muddy as they were. I kind of like T-Birds. What's your lean?
Over was my lean.
Over
Grand Canyon. Yeah. Someone mentioned in the chat they've been an over machine lately, playing a lot faster. Yes, agreed. And Southern Utah will run. So definitely lean to the over there. Kai, is 18 points too many for the Georgetown Hoyas heading to Omaha to take on Creighton, who, by the way, just lost over the weekend? I could see Creighton absolutely destroying them.
I can too. I made this game 18 as well. So line does not point me in either direction. Creighton's really good at home. They need to get their predictive analytics back up also after a couple of tough losses. So lean towards Creighton blowing them out.
What's Wahab's status?
Like, so name, didn't he just kind of like leave the team? I thought that was what his status is like.
He's like
just
they gone. Have zero chance to defend anyone at the rim without him.
Yep. And Villanova beat them by moving Kalkbrenner around with a 5-man shooting threes. Georgetown cannot do that at all. I think this is a big old smash for Creighton, first half or full game. Up to you. Matthew, I'm going to ask you about a team that I know you don't like. That's Wagner. They're a 2-point road dog at Sacred Heart to start the NEC. Tell me why the Seahawks are about to go on a run.
I got them on the card today, Jim. So I have real dollars wagered on my Seahawks. As I mentioned earlier, I am on all three road dogs in this conference tournament, except for Central Connecticut, who's going to Loretto, Pennsylvania, as I mentioned, the one place I think has legit home court. Seahawks are just better than Sacred Heart. They've been up and down all year. They've played their best against the best competition. They won at Merrimack, won at Fairleigh Dickinson. They're just better than these weird, like, they got dragged down into playing a bad team and were disinterested in loss. So they're not a trustworthy team because they foul a lot and they're very frustrating. But they're the most talented team in this conference, I think, top to bottom. I'm backing them here.
Can I jump in? It's my best bet.
Yes. Attaboy, Kai.
Oh, my bad, Kai. I totally forgot.
Wagner plus two. Best bet. It's actually mostly a gut play for me. They're the best team in the NEC, I think, per Matt's discussion. You know what? I'm going to back that up. They're the best team per KenPom. I'm not sure they're the best team. I'm not convinced because their offense is brutal. Their defense is great. I think the defense is going to translate to the tournament, to the NEC tournament. Like I've said before, besides Loretto, besides St. Francis University, home court's nothing in the NEC, and they have a major rebounding edge. Best offensive rebounding rate in the NEC versus the eighth best defensive rebounding team in the conference. Wagner plus two is my best bet. So Matt and I are aligned here.
Let's go.
Love it. Sorry, Kai, for stepping on toes there.
That's all right,
just
there,
a,
Jim.
Just a brain fart.
Merrimack's been really good. We should probably dub them the best team. That's
the I think, team. Yes, Merrimack's the best team.
They've been awesome. Yes. So
another Southland total. Kelly asked about Sela and Houston Christian. This one's actually been bet down. I mean, it's open 165. They're certainly anticipating a mega shootout here. Sela also a 3.5-point road favorite. I kind of lean towards the under the way the money has bet it. Houston Christian isn't that fast offensively, but they're such a layup line on D that it's hard to get excited about any kind of an under bet with them. No real take on the total. Kai, I'm going to go to you for Oklahoma at Kansas State. A Big 12 game did not make the outline. Kansas State laying 7.5 to the Sooners. Oklahoma is probably an overall record away from being in considered for the tournament. Like, yeah, they've got 8 quad one, quad two wins, but they're under 500 overall, so can't even think about them.
Yeah, it's wild, right? Under 500, but 8 Q1, Q2 wins. That's the Big 12. Someone's got to be the low record team, despite being a pretty good squad. Interesting thing I saw. So every single Big 12 team outranks Pitt in KenPom right now. Pitt, the perhaps the ACC champion. Every single team in Big 12 ranks higher than Pitt, would be favored on a neutral. That's wild to me. Just shows you the difference in conferences. I lean toward OU ever so slightly. I do love the Octagon of Doom, the home court. I don't think it's as big or as intimidating today against Oklahoma coming to town. And OU's really scrappy. They're tough. They hang around. So lean OU.
All right. I believe that is it for Chat Mob. Sorry if I missed anything. I tried to follow it, but may or may not have missed a game or two. Best bets. Go to that, even though I already spoiled Cox. Come on, Jim, lock it up.
That's okay.
Lock it up. It's March. You got to be sharper. It's March. all right. My best bet is South Florida at minus 14. They are taking on Tulsa. Again, this is mostly about Tulsa. Tulsa's terrible. They're 4-22 against the spread this year. 4-22 against the spread. That is shocking. 1-8-1 against the spread their last 10, not covering by an average of 9.7 points a game. Their only cover in that span was losing by 2 to East Carolina, a game they did not cover when I had East Carolina's best bet, but then they announced Sam Griffin out and the line kind of inflated up to 3 or 4, and they covered that closing line. But Griffin and Pritchard still have been out for Tulsa. Now they've got to go to Tampa to play this game finale when they've clearly kind of rolled over, given up. I don't think they have any interest in this game playing a team that they lost by 26 against 2 weeks ago. So Florida minus 14, long-winded way of saying that. Matthew, to you.
This is kind of a put up or shut up best bet for me with SIU, Edwardsville, our Cougars, Brian Baroni. Just a really tough close to the regular season. As Kai kind of alluded to with his Wagner best bet, it's just a gut for me. They're going into a hostile environment. This will be played at the Ford Center, which is a neutral venue in Evansville, but Southern Indiana is based in Evansville. They should have a massive crowd there. But SIU has already won at USI, I should say, this season. And they won that game despite going 4 of 21 from 3. They're just more athletic. They're bigger. I think similar to the Wagner angle Kai mentioned, again, they can just punish the inferior athletic team at the rim. And I think you just kind of put to bed all the recent results that you saw from SIUE. I think you see more of the team that was phenomenal in the non-conference, including, you know, winning at SLU, winning at Longwood, beating Troy, nearly beating Bradley at home, for goodness sake. Even competed with Mizzou for a hot second there. So yeah, I think it's a good team. Minus two against a team that, you know, good but not great. I'll take it. Give me SIUE.
Reminder on my best bet. Before I do, hit the like button, please, if you don't mind. Also, reminder, we have our live podcast coming up, Three Man Weave live podcast at 1:30. We'll send out a link on our Twitter, so stay tuned for that. My best bet was Wagner plus two. Go Seahawks, looking for the upset over Sacred Heart in the AC tournament. All right, thanks a lot, guys, for joining us once again on our Best Bet show. Thank you to BetRivers. Thank you to Field of 68. We are back tomorrow, same time, 12 p.m. Central. 1 p.m. Eastern. We'll see you then. Good luck on your bets.